Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I am going to cover C++ 23's stacktrace library. It looks to be very interesting indeed. I just want to remind you that I am available for code reviews, on-site training, and there's a bunch of links in this video description that you should absolutely check out. So to get this working with GCC today, I'm in Compiler Explorer and I have the current trunk build of GCC selected. I have enabled C++ 23 mode here. And I have explicitly linked to -l stdc++ lib backtrace. Now this is necessary to actually be able to execute a project that has a backtrace in it. And we're going to play with a few things. Now first I have all of the debugging symbols at the moment enabled. And if I turn them off, I don't expect that we'll see much of a difference here. I'm also currently compiling with -03 instead of, say, -00. And we will play with this and we will see what we learn about how the stack trace changes or does not change, depending on what optimization level we have enabled. So in its most simple form, this is what it looks like. I am getting the current backtrace, and then I am printing it with standard toString. It has a toString overload available to it. And we get this nice, pretty output here. Well, the first three levels seem less than useful, shall we say. It's probably in the standard library somewhere in the launch code, pre-main execution kinds of things, the things that actually launch main. And then we see this example.cpp:7, and it isn't even telling us that we're in main at the moment. So maybe this will improve or change, I'm not sure. But let's go ahead and add a function that we're gonna call from main. And I'm just gonna go ahead and put this in here. Okay, so now we start to get something a little bit interesting. We see this func called at example.cpp:7. Now, I'm building with -00. I'm gonna go ahead and put this in 03 mode because we would expect func to have been inlined into main. That would be something we would very much expect to happen. And yet, in the stack trace, we're still getting the whole stack trace, which I find a little surprising. I'm not really sure what to make of that. We can try to dig into it here, but oh goodness, it generates really a fair bit of code. Let's see, in main, func did not get inlined. Okay. So let's just go ahead and see, like, does stacktrace somehow prevent inlining? So maybe we would see func skipped or func2 skipped, depending on whether or not any inlining happened here. And no, we don't. We don't see any inlining at all happening, which is interesting. So if I were to do something like this, now if we go into main, we see that func and func2 have both been inlined, and it's a simple call to basic ostream cout for hello world. So I don't know if stacktrace is preventing inlining in some way, but we'll dig into that. So let's go ahead and create a struct. Now, I'm going to have my classic struct s, and the point is that I'm going to have this dump a stack trace whenever its constructor is called. So this is no longer trivially constructible, but it is still trivially destructible, copyable, and movable, so we don't expect to see other things happening there. Let's go ahead and create an object and see if any of this nature changes. Okay, very good. So we're starting to see, in fact, some inlining. We can see that func has been removed, and we only see the call to func 2. So let's go ahead and take our optimization level back down and just to verify that we do in fact see the whole stack trace here. Okay, very good. We did. Okay, this makes sense. Now, interestingly, we're seeing some calls to isConstant evaluated here. I don't think that stack trace is usable in a constexpr context, but we can just go ahead and give that a try real quick if we were so inclined. Now, what's the best I could do? I could return it from a constexpr function. Yeah, no, this is not going to compile. So that's not an option. We can't do a compile time stack trace. Although that could have some potentially interesting consequences. I'm going to also try this. I would like to have a default initialized parameter in a function here and just say, I want to see what happens in a stack trace from a parameter being default constructed. Okay, so we see here that func, when it calls func 2, so we're actually getting the stack trace printed before the invocation of func 2, which is correct. That's when this function parameter would have to have its lifetime begin. So that makes sense. So, of course, this is going to be the kind of interesting thing to play with, but perhaps not the most useful thing in your actual code. But, of course, we have to keep trying these things, right? So I am calling func, which calls func2, which calls an immediately invoked lambda that has an object of type s that is unnamed that is created on the stack for us. So we see on line 7, and then we have line 15, where I have greatly confused it, which is good fun. It's not telling us the name of the lambda here. We're still in O0 mode. Let's go ahead and play a little bit with our debug symbol settings. Yeah, so we can really see these things kind of get optimized out now, and that's not as useful of information as we might have hoped of, but it is actually telling us at runtime what was the stack trace. So that's what we have. We have the ability to get a stack trace in runtime in C++ with, shockingly, a handy function to actually output a pretty stack trace for us. All right, let's look at the actual API for this quickly now that we have a feel for what it can do. Okay, so let's take a quick look at the API for Backtrace. Now, perhaps not surprisingly, it is allocator aware, and we can have a PMR enabled Backtrace. That's cool if you are concerned about your allocation strategy while looking at Backtrace things. So Backtrace is basically just a limited container, actually. So it doesn't look like we can do anything with it other than a Backtrace entry. So don't get any ideas about trying to use this with, you know, a vector replacement or something like that. But otherwise, it looks and smells an awful lot like a regular container in C++. So you should be able to use it with ranges and that sort of thing. Now, you could, I guess, maybe construct your own from scratch if you really wanted to, but you probably want to do the current stack trace like we just did. Now, you can see it has other things like you can skip items, the number of stack trace entries to skip if you're so inclined, and you can specify the max depth that you want to get. But then the real question is, what do you actually get from it? And that is a stack trace entry. Now, this is where I get slightly confused, Because, well, it has things like the description and source file and source line. That makes sense. And then we can see here in the CBP reference documentation that you might want to see also source location. Now, I've done an episode about C++ 20's source location, and it has a lot of interesting properties. And it has a line, a column, a file name, and a function name. Now, it would seem to me that a stack trace entry should be effectively a source location, but it doesn't seem to be a source location. Maybe because of inlining and the as-if rule and all of these things, you don't know exactly where that code came from, perhaps. I mean, as we already saw with optimizations enabled, your stack trace might not exactly represent the source code that you expect it to. It's just going to tell you what functions have been called to get to where you currently are. So maybe that's why they didn't use source location, and I'm sure I could go and look up whether or not source location was discussed. It probably was. But another thing that is interesting to me is that these source file is actually a standard string. Now, generally speaking, the standard tries to avoid pulling in dependencies from other parts of the library where it can. I'm surprised it's standard string instead of a const character pointer or perhaps even a string view, but it returns a standard string, not even a const reference to one. It is a standard string object, if this is correct. And that is also true for the description. So it doesn't really say what the description is, but description of the evaluation represented by this thing. Maybe not quite the level of detail that you're hoping for, but at the same time, I'm expecting that we're going to be able to see some rather interesting application to exceptions at this point. Now, I know exception is a little bit of a bad word in C++ today, but there are great things you can do with exceptions in the case of truly exceptional cases and error handling. And if you could throw an exception that contains a full stack trace and the source location for where that, object was first constructed, or if you use these things to combine them, stack trace with source location inside like your logger, for example, really some very powerful possibilities coming here once we see full compiler support for both source location in C++ 20 and stack trace in C++ 23. So I'm looking forward to being able to play with this more. Again, this is just preliminary support in GCC. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe.